2020 and beginning of 2021, there was a lull in the coronavirus pandemic, and a lot of states were finding it very easy to pass anti-trans legislations. Taking a stab at this phenomenon of trans hate was only the natural next step for the right-leaning state of Arkansas. Keep in mind, anytime I'm using terms associated with the LGBTQ+ community, it is entirely non-derogatory. Now, prior to our nation's obsession with bullying trans people in the law, and controlling what seems like all of healthcare, there are many strides despite pushback in the LGBTQ+ community. Keep in mind that in 1868, the 14th Amendment was ratified, which was supposed to protect against discrimination in the law. And 1949 marked the beginning of hormone therapy use. Harry Benjamin, a physician, believed that many people may feel that they were assigned the wrong sex at birth, and that counseling was not enough for their mental aid. He then advocated for his patients to take hormone therapy. In 1959, there was a situation where a trans woman was unable to get married to her husband due to her birth-assigned sex. And then there's a Stonewall Uprising. In 1969, when being part of the LGBTQ+ community was illegal, the Stonewall Uprising occurred. This was prefaced by many police riots on the gay bar, Stonewall Inn. Calling this uprising a riot gives the police just action. In 2007, the Employment Non-Discrimination Act was filed. Although this did not accompany discrimination on the basis of gender identity, that was later added in 2009. And finally, in 2015, there's a ban on penalizing gay marriage in any U.S. state. Now, I'll be focusing on three major bills throughout this video, with a few honorary mentions of others. Those three main bills being House Bill 1570, 1749, and 1882. On February 21st of 2021, Republican Robin Lundstrom filed House Bill 1570, titling it, To Create the Arkansas Save Adolescents from Experimentation, (SAFE) Act. This bill was to enact restrictions upon hormone therapy and gender-affirming surgery in vulnerable children. The official publication of this bill starts off talking about how only a small percentage of the American population experiences distress at identifying with their biological sex. It then goes into detail about how we're experimenting on our children by allowing them hormone therapy. It says this by saying, the prescribing of puberty-blocking drugs is being done despite the lack of any long-term longitudinal studies evaluating the risks and benefit of using these drugs for the treatment of such distress or gender transition. The writers of this bill then go on to describe the long-term longitudinal risks of taking these treatments. As evidenced by this blatant contradiction, they clearly weren't thinking this out well enough to warrant restricting healthcare. However, they do go on to talk about gender-affirming surgery. Although, I don't think they're entirely wrong to want to change the restrictions on surgery for minors. I want to emphasize how I didn't say that they weren't wrong for trying to cut gender-affirming surgery for minors. I just said that they need to change the restrictions upon it. As an individual, I only know so much about hormone therapy. However, I do know that medical professionals and welfare groups do know a lot about this topic, and many oppose this bill, cementing the idea that the politicians' conservative aggressions were the leading force behind this bill and not the well-being of the general populace. One man stood out surprisingly more than everyone else. Asa Hutchinson, someone who is a major driving force behind Act 461, which made it illegal for trans students to play on sports teams consistent with their identifying gender, and also a major pushing force behind anti-abortion laws. This H.A. Hutchinson opposed House Bill 1570, saying it went too far interfering with parents and physicians, and this wasn't the only reason. He also commented on him vetoing the bill due to pediatricians, social workers, and the parents of trans youth, telling him it would harm a community already prone to depression and suicide. To say that hormone therapy hasn't been experimented with is just naive. For this specific application, it's been used for at least 70 years, maybe even up to 110 years. It originally started with Magnus Hirschfeld, the first recorded doctor to use hormone therapy for his transgender patients. Given it was called transsexual at the time and not transgender as it is today, but it translates to the exact same thing. However, the first well-known individual to use hormone therapy was Christine Jorgensen, a celebrity in the 1950s. She was the one to start the spread of hormone therapy and gender-affirming treatments. This has been going on since at least the 1950s, then there's definitely evidence of long-term longitudinal effects of hormone therapy. Now, I really do wish I could say that House Bill 1570 was the only anti-trans bill that Arkansas politicians tried to pass, but that's just not true. Just under a month after 1570, on March 16th, 2021, Arkansas made another attempt at harming the trans youth, this time attacking their identities. House Bill 1749 was filed and named to prohibit requiring public school and institutions of higher education employees from addressing a student by a term that identifies the student as male or female and that is inconsistent with the student's biological sex. Now, why the name is so long, I'll never know. However, the original reason for the bill being passed was to ensure that teachers don't get sued for misidentifying a student. Just like what we did with the last bill, and we're gonna do with the next one. Here's an example. This is a clip of the first lawsuit that had occurred before the bill had been filed. As of this long-titled bill being filed, that lawsuit is yet to happen, and didn't happen throughout the duration of the bill in court, nullifying a solid part of the argument. And I mean this, no teacher has, from what I found, ever been sued for misidentifying a student. In fact, the only lawsuits ever filed in this department was teachers suing their higher-ups for making them identify students by their preferred pronouns and name. The suggested form of identification for these students on the bill was basically just a state-given identification. This confirms the student's biological sex and gives no place for a preferred pronoun or preferred name. And welcome back our friend, Asa Hutchinson! When House Bill 1749 was proposed to Asa Hutchinson, he said it was unnecessary and asked the Board of Education to rethink their decision of letting it pass. And the last thing I'm going to say on this bill is that it's genuinely one of the most offensive ones. To quote an Arkansas Democratic lawmaker and member of the House of Representatives for Arkansas, Fred Love, "Not referring to someone by their personal identity is one of the most disrespectful things you can do. Referring to them as using proper pronoun and title is not harming you and not doing so only harms them. Something vital to emotional and psychological development is knowing who you are and figuring out your identity." And at this point, lawmakers are only bullying children into submission with this bill. Notice the words I emphasize there. Attacking, child, bullying. Politicians are attacking and bullying children on their identity, not untested experiments. This last bill, House Bill 1882, allows for a government entity to be sued for allowing someone into a restroom, washroom, or shower room inconsistent with that of their biological sex while inside of a government building. This official bill starts out with identifying their definition of some terms, so I'm going to do the same. As they describe it in the bill and how I'll be using it, sex means a person's immutable or not changing biological sex as objectively determined by anatomy and genetics existing at the time of birth. It also states that this is identified by government-given ID, aka birth certificate. Now I should give them some credit. One could get special admission to a bathroom that they identify with if that bathroom is totally empty. This bill doesn't inherently prevent people who don't identify by their sex from using a restroom or shower room while in a government building, but it does apply limitations to a situation that didn't have limitations prior, like having to get accommodation. In fact, other than needing the accommodations, it doesn't affect the trans person from what I can tell. It only affects the government, as this bill states that they can get sued for giving these accommodations. However, this one I think is the most reasonable of the ones I've mentioned thus far. It seems to me as though they were trying to keep in mind the comfort of the general populace. This wasn't meant to attack trans people, I think. Even though it is marketed as such by the media, after having read it, it seems like it's not really an anti-trans legislation. It seems like it was really just meant to ensure that people don't walk from bathroom to bathroom, ensuring safety of the general populace. Accommodations are given to most everyone who, for any reason, is unwilling or unable to use a multi-occupancy restroom or changing facility that is A, designated for the person's sex, or B, located within a government building. Or you can submit a written request to the government entity that the government entity provides a reasonable accommodation. Those are the only requirements. They also state that the bill does not prevent government facilities from creating policies that accommodate disabled people or children who need assistance, which is all reasonable, until you get to page 3. If someone runs into another of the opposite sex in a changing room or restroom who is given accommodations by the government entity to be in said area, the government entity is eligible for being sued by them. Now, the next is a quote from the original bill document. The government entity can be sued if one is forced to use sleeping quarters with someone who is of the opposite sex and was given permission to use said quarters, unless they are family. Lawmakers are so focused on making the trans experience different from that of the cisgendered that they're willing to get sued to ensure this. But generally, this bill doesn't change much for trans people and really just harms the government. All it does is apply a limitation that is easily overcome, or just don't go into a bathroom in a government facility. Plus, this wasn't even passed, so I mean. However, government facilities, if this passed, could be under pressure from the anti-trans community and not be able to support causes they may deem fit to be supported if they're correlated to the trans community. The ones typically opposing these are labeled as conservatives. They might bring up something like religion, which is irrelevant in a secular state such as the US. In specific relation to trans rights, a conservative's typical argument may be that we don't know what we're doing and we're experimenting on people, as mentioned before, or that the people in question are just unwell or mentally not okay. Progressives usually have a pretty opposing view. They believe that everyone is valid, that everyone should be totally equal, and that everyone's body is their own. They believe you can be whoever you want to be as long as you're not harming yourself or others. And there are most people who just don't care about political affiliation. They believe what they believe, and that's totally disassociated from political belief. Asa Hutchinson, I believe, is kind of like this. From what I read and from the very limited perspective I have on him, he seems to believe what he wants, totally unrelated to anyone else. In fact, Donald Trump called him a rhino, a Republican in name only, because of his opposing to some of the trans laws that we talked about. In fact, I can see why he might support Act 461, not allowing trans youth to play in the sports of the team that they identify with. For example, masculine muscle mass takes a year or two to deteriorate on hormone therapy. That may give a trans feminine student an advantage over the cisgendered female students participating in the sport. There should be restrictions consistent with this fact, not a ban. Hormone therapy does not harm anyone. Sure, there can be side effects, but there's painful side effects to Advil as well, and you don't see politicians trying to ban that, and that's for a reason. The euphoric feeling many may get after seeing the changes their body goes through while on hormone therapy is insurmountable, but that doesn't mean that whoever takes it is an idiot. Someone who takes hormone therapy knows the risks. Just the same as any patient taking any life-altering medication, they're aware of the risks and they are told the risks. And as prior mentioned, we've been using hormone therapy for this exact reason for decades. All of what I've said are generalizations. They're used to help everyone understand the premise of what I'm talking about. A brief introduction into the side of politics, a side that probably shouldn't even exist. Everyone is their own person, and they aren't harming themselves any more than anyone is whenever they're taking antidepressants or anxiety medication. It improves their mood, potentially preventing extreme depression or suicide, which sounds extreme but is extremely common. Politicians are loving the conservative principles right now. The principles that kept racial segregation in public and government establishments. The principles that sold the idea that masculinity is so vitally important to society that you're weak if you have depression or anxiety. Conservatism has only brought mental atrophy to those who are affected by it. Trans people already have very high suicide and depression rates. Not to mention politicians taking one of the few things away that makes them feel normal and euphoric after having it promised to them. This would be incredibly detrimental to the already incredibly fragile psyche. Let's say we stick with the ideas of conservatism. One of the founding principles of America was the pursuit of happiness. When politicians are taking this away from a major group in America, it's harming not only the basis of America, the LGBTQ plus community, but conservatives themselves.